Making a life worth living in retirement worth having is about the people in our lives. It's about the people in our lives that profess to be our loved ones, that are our spouses, our significant others, our life partners, our strategic alliances in business, and predominantly our children and those who become amongst our family. Whether they're still part of our birth family in terms of our brothers and sisters in this lifetime, or whether they're actually brothers and sisters that came from other mothers, is something that is often joked about in many films today. The reality is it's the people in our lives that make life worth living. It's those opportunities that we gain from connecting with new people, from making strategic alliances, from making profitable partnerships, and from getting paid by companies who produce for us from our performance in that employment little situation. Now, when I'm talking like this, it makes total sense to most people. When I talk about producing an income in 20 hours a week, people sort of are like, really, you did that? But it wasn't like Mega Millions. It was enough to live on for three people. It was enough to have family days on Friday. It was enough to put family first, if you will, like many people talk about. And openly, it allowed us to have relationships outside of the workforce. By working in an employment situation, we are locked into the other colleagues and other coworkers that we are employed with. A lot of people make mistakes in where they go to work because they're interested in the job, but they don't think about who am I going to be employed with. On the reverse side, there are people who are employed with other colleagues and coworkers from social networking opportunities that produce themselves, but they may not be able to perform the job in the best way that they can. Openly, that is the crapshoot of all employment situations. If you attend any local networking professional exchange group that is helping people to mentor them into a new position because either they've lost the job or they're in the process of losing a job or they might like to lose a job, it's really more about how do we help them to produce the highest level of life they possibly can. Is it not? I mean, there are career ministries in the community that offer all sorts of services from people who are volunteering to help people to do better in their thinking, better in their planning, better in their emotional health, because the roller coaster ride of looking for a job can be very stressful for some people. But at the same time, there's a lot of loss of job going on. You see, these applicant tracking systems are removing people from the process. In truth, all our technology removes people from the process. You see, the technology plays itself out alone in its own algorithms and other things that allow the phones to work, that allow the faxes to run, that allow the emails to be sent and received, and openly that allow our social media channels that are free or paid to get literally through to the people we're trying to connect with. You see, the slippery slope of technology is whether or not we are really getting what we pay for, either in terms of personal, professional, individual time management that we're utilizing to produce our online presence, and whether or not we receive a result from that effort, or whether or not we're paying for a service, and literally whether or not we're truly reaping the rewards and the return on investment of that financial implication that we've decided to choose and then lend our trust to in a corporation. Now, in my life, I've been hit by a lot of people thinking that rights didn't matter so much in these sales relationships. But at the same time, I've reproduced a lot of life in an early part of my professional realm that allowed me to live in a happy way. Now, for you, what's it like? Are you pleased with your work? Are you happy with your colleagues? And are you really getting to the level of lifestyle in terms of how you can live your life in the type of home you want, the type of car you prefer to drive, and openly in the food that you put within your body based on the level of income that you're able to afford, and the shopping and the restaurants that you're literally able to go to, and the movies and the travel that you want to do based on where you've progressed in your career? Now, when I talk like this, I lose a lot of people in LinkedIn because people don't always like to be reminded of the actual truth of their lives. They don't like to feel that they're being hammered by someone they don't know seriously enough to have those real life conversations. But if we don't remind ourselves of the importance of the people of our lives, then we forget the point of these conversations. You see, it's the people in our lives, it's the people that we meet as strangers who become our fast little friends, who are the folks who call us every single day and text with us to the point that we really fall somewhat in love with their personalities and their souls, that make our lives worth living. They make our heart beat faster. They make our tone and our rhythm of life be be more joyous and openly, it's those people that help us to make a life worth living. You see, the profession just pays for that life worth living, but it's the people that produces the opportunities for socialization, as well as teamwork, as well as making projects, as well as strategic alliances and profitable partnerships like I talked about earlier, that really allow us to have the life worth living and eventually that retirement worth having. Now, if I'm not making sense, then by all means, shut me off. But if I'm making some sense and you really like what I've said here in different ways that I've talked about it, sharing some of my life struggle since someone decided to manhandle my rights into something that was not their lawful right to do and get away with it for their lies, maybe you'll think about how easy it is that it could literally happen to you. But that's not ever the point of my audiocasts or my podcast interviews that I've done with some world-famous authors. What I'm really talking about is how literally important it is for people to shorten their online time and lengthen their offline time in real-life phone chats, in video conference calls that allows you to see the person you're talking to, and openly having those face-to-face meetings that are actually productive. The other day, I think I told a story about how I watched and had to suffer through hearing a meeting between men that literally seemed to be going absolutely nowhere in terms of planning, in terms of productivity, or in terms of any type of literal performance in the area of technology that was supposedly going to be bought and sold. And I sat there and I thought, wow, in this amount of time, we could have planned a lot more. We could have done a lot of the technological services that needed to be produced. And openly, there's always something that can go wrong in those situations because technology is not always run by people. Sometimes it's an automated system. Now, automated systems do have a cost, and there is a service fee for those things, but it's the people in our lives, the networking that we do, the lunches we attend, the money we have to go to those places that allow us to produce a life worth living and retirement worth having. When we can't produce any longer, when we go through a personal loss, when we're attacked in some way by technology or by the companies themselves, literally picking and choosing who's going to become famous and who's not, it's sort of a rare thing to really think about the realities that technology is one of the few service providers in the world that doesn't exactly have a checks and balances. It's hard for the average Joe to check to make sure his emails are coming through without calling a company that could tell them they are, but it may not be. It's also very hard to produce an income if you're not able to use a telephone like what happened to me when I was in a Starbucks. My phone is always set up to be ready to be pulled and looked at, but for some reason someone logged me out, and when I try to go log back in, I can't get logged back in. And because I'm in an email situation right now, I can't get the code that would allow me to do that, and it creates a real problem in terms of being able to listen to someone or hear their message or find out if a job opportunity came through, or mainly just make calls for help. You see, in our lifetime, we have opportunities to help people, but sometimes we just sit back and say, it's not my problem. But what we have to look at in those moments of time is whether or not the Lord in heaven, for those of you who have a faith or profess to have a belief of something in a higher power realm or a divine architect, have actually thought about what you look like to that higher being. Do you actually look like you're a loving soul of that being, or do you look miserly in what you're doing to people? Do you look like you're manhandling someone's life and mismanaging some plan that God has put in place for them? You see, in our lifetime, we can't say the plans that a heavenly divine architect has put in place for us. We do know that when people mucky that up, that sometimes his workers have to work harder to put things back in place so that the whole world of chaos and order doesn't go out of whack. But openly, I'm talking about something profound, am I not? Because I'm mixing the concept of business and I'm mixing the concept with faith. But a lot of people profess to be faith, and we have these Christian-based blue pages and yellow pages that are based on supposedly people who are of faith who run those things. But at the same time, those people have very stern different ideas about how they're going to produce their life sometimes. They often look at whether or not they're producing enough living. They look at whether or not the persons that are trying to buy from them are worthy of their sales. And at the same time, they're looking at how to sell other people in a way that makes them look valuable to those prospects and those eventual clients. So in truth, we're all in the same boat. Regardless of what our position is in a firm, whether we're a humble bread maker who works in the middle of the night to make sure we have breakfast food in the morning, or whether we're a high-level executive who is sharing his wealth across a platform of people because he is the leader of it all or she is the leader of it all, is mainly what we're talking about. You see, making a life worth living in retirement with having is totally about the people in our lives. It's the people that we trust. It's the people that we care for. But it's more importantly, it's the people that we raise up in their life and in God's plan for them. If we think we have a plan for them, that's probably out of line with what God's plan is for them. A person's natural gifts and skill sets are always visible based on the passion and the light that radiates from their eyes when they talk about what they love to do in their work. And that's the part that a lot of people don't miss out on, but they don't always see how to handle that and how to harness that and how to help themselves release that joy of the Lord in terms of what the Lord has put in their soul to become in life into a practical and performance-oriented way. They can talk about God all day long. They can certainly get off on tangents of what they think is and isn't moral. But the truth is, only the Lord can say what is moral, and that's pretty practically written in just about every piece of literature from historic worth of what happened in Bible times for those who profess that sort of oriented faith. Now, when I talk like this, I'm not trying to be subversive. I'm not trying to be difficult. I'm just trying to say, in life, we have moments of time to make a difference for someone. That moment might be a five-minute moment in a restaurant between a store manager and a guest, or it might be a lifetime relationship that is really what customer service is about. You see, I might go to a shop today and not go to it tomorrow, but if I'm well treated by a shop person, I might literally go every single day. And there was a time when I literally ate at Panera Bread every single day of my life, practically. Because I would get up, I'd go out in the morning, and I would simply sit there, do my work, and I'd eat breakfast with the money I had in my pocket. And openly, that made me a lifetime customer based on how I was treated by the managers and the staff on duty. Now, life has moved forward. I've been attending those restaurants a long time. I'm not professing anything other than the truth. We all have these favorite spots that we like to go. But when someone infiltrates that, when someone destroys that opportunity, when someone lies to someone about why we're there, what we're doing, it doesn't make a lot of sense to continue, but it's truthful in the way that the Lord is not going to help or harm someone's life. But men do this. Women do this. They interfere and infiltrate a person's opportunities in life and simply say, we're not going to allow this. Well, I'd like to say, what gave them the right to do that? I don't recall God putting his hand down from heaven saying, you there will literally go and make sure this person doesn't go on in life. You see, that's a man-made construct. The Lord that I believe in, and that many people I know of faith believe in, is a loving God who wants the best for all of us, who practically puts people in our lives to make relationships work, to give us lessons in life, sometimes to give us harsh lessons in life, but rarely are we the teachers of those lessons. This is something that sometimes older siblings and other senior-oriented staff fail to remember, that the lessons in life are not theirs to teach unless they are officially in a mentoring role, and if they're not, then they're out of line trying to mentor those things. And in truth, those who try to manhandle someone's life are likely to get hit with lawsuit, rights violations, and other aspects of the world that literally say we have rights to our lives underneath not only the Lord in heaven, but also underneath the national flag of which we fly in America, that we practically have rights to our life and that no one has the right to take away our life or kill our life. Thou shalt not kill is pretty clearly in the Bible, but also we have those laws in the land. We have moved beyond the Great Plains Wild West terms of, you know, prospecting and miners and the shots and the the old time duels at noon, but openly we are now in a land of technology which can sort of be utilized in the same way if the person literally has no ethics and no gumption about destroying another person's opportunities. You see, it's those monsters that we sort of have to be concerned with. And the technology companies sometimes employ them because they're sophisticated in technological skill sets, but they haven't really evaluated them in terms of their morals or in terms of their etiquette, because in business, we don't talk about morals much. We do literally talk about ethics. We talk about integrity of a company. And I remember reading some wonderful codes of ethics from some major corporations when I was in manufacturing and sharing those things through a way that made sense to our corporation to help get employees on the right track in their productivity and their performance in a shop floor that literally did boring work in theory, in that it was about melding parts together. But once you reminded those employees of the fact that those parts were literally being the safety of our vehicles, it made all the difference in the world to those temporary workers and to the long-term workers. They started to realize how important their job was. their job was to protect people's lives in those vehicles, even though they were just welding a bolt onto a part. You see, it's all about how we sell things, and in truth, the selling of a performance is not what we're trying to do when we're literally getting a job. We are literally trying to sell our opportunities to improve ourselves through the performance of a new job with new people, new work, new projects, and all aspects of that opportunity. You see, when I sell a marketing plan, I'm usually selling the executive. I'm also talking to the executive about marketing, and if his little mind can't go where I can go marketing-wise, then we get literally nowhere, and he might not get anywhere either in his work, but there's no guarantees in marketing. We always know that, but in truth, we're also looking at how we market ourselves. I've sort of shifted how I look. I don't look anything like I did. I've literally lost 14 inches around my waist, and I'm a bald-headed man now, which I wasn't before. But I had to clean myself up, and some lovely ladies in a shop helped me, and that was a kindness. Now, in life, we have moments of time to help people. We have moments in time to harm people. The only question in life really is, who are you in the Lord's house? Isn't that what we kind of look at in the end of our lives? Is as we start to age, as we start to progress through the cellular degeneration of our little bones and our little skin that's literally covering our entire being, we are looking at how will we age? Are we producing enough educational information about what we need to do for our cellular health in order to keep it healthy? Are we producing enough quality food in our bodies that is actually fitting for our bodies? You see, the minute I started listening to the Lord about my food, I started to have a better, sleaner look. But that was a submission I had to practice, and it really did work. And openly, that's why I'm down 14 inches off my waist. Now, in life, we have other methods and other styles and other strategies and other food partaking that can do that. But if it's not a fit for our bodies, it may not be a fit for our life. The same can be said for all sorts of aspects of physical beings. But in our lifetime, it's the Lord who produces that being, no one else, right? Sure, our parents had some, you know, chemistry that was literally going on between their lovemaking, but in truth, it's the Lord that puts the soul into an individual. It's the Lord that gifts the individual with gifts of spirit, and it's the Lord that gives the person their talents that are usually facilitated and fostered, we hope, by loving parents who recognize those internal gifts and allow that person to thrive to the best of their ability until they're literally on their own in adulthood. There are monsters in this world that do try to damage the soul, that do try to interfere with what God is trying to plan for someone, and do literally go out of their way to call people to interfere with their opportunities in life, to slander others. Whether it's true or not true is not the point. That they just like to gossip, they like to damage lives, and they don't think one thing about what it literally means in front of the Lord. Now, I can talk about that, and those people of faith who have a concept of a divine architect and have seen the science enough to know that it's almost impossible to prove that there's not a divine architect these days, is not about the faith concept of ethics or races or any other aspect of religion. What it's really about is allowing a divine Lord, regardless of a person's spirituality, to be in control of one's life. And when men try to control other people's lives, they usually muck it up. They also monkey up their own lives and their own opportunities, because the Bible's pretty clear. Thou shall not interfere with the Lord's plan is not exactly a Bible verse, but we have plenty of information in that historic work and others like it that literally say that. That when you monkey around with God's plan, you end up messing your own life up considerably. Now, in this lifetime, we have many opportunities to make a difference for people. We can help them, we can shelter them, we can feed them, we can employ them, we can give them religious rights, or we can openly give them no life at all. In your life, what do you want to be remembered for? How many lives do you want to be remembered for touching, for lifting up, for raising into a higher presence in this planet? Or how many lives will you be accountable for later for destroying, for literally obliterating their opportunities in life? You see, when it comes to performance in a job, we don't always remember that. I've been told off by several employees of major corporations who didn't actually understand the marketing moment in time would have been to simply politely come over, introduce themselves, ask a few questions, find out whether or not their thinking on a matter was correct or not, and then figure a diplomatic way to provide information about the store rules or policies or anything else. When they don't literally do that, they make a monstrous opportunity for a lawsuit, as well as other opportunities for slander, for Police harassment and hazing and mobbing and other people participate in that. Now, at this time, I'm not going to talk about that, but I literally do like to let people know that in this world, we have moments of time to make all the difference for other people. Whether the person is struggling with homelessness, or whether the person is looking for a job, or whether the person is just looking for a meal today, it's really about what can we do to help someone, isn't it? Isn't that what professionally we're supposed to be doing in our jobs? Is serving people in a way we can, and if we've got the flexibility and freedom to help someone, shouldn't we actually do that? You see, in life, people will tell you the truth, and there's a handful of people who will lie to you, but the reality is the most humblest of the humble, the meekest of the meek, are looking for ways to get out of their situations. Those people are on the Lord's path to a point, but they're also on your path in your life, trying to move themselves out of struggle into something better in life, just like you. No different than any person who's listening to this audiocast still, or who might be willing to say, this guy's really trying to move my soul to make a difference for other people. You see, that's what I'm really marketing here, people, is I'm trying to say, look, we've got moments in time that are fleeting, tons of moments to make an impact on someone in a positive way. And if we all put forward a peaceful effort, if we all really decided to make a difference in the plan that that individual had for their life, then maybe there'd be less mayhem in the world, there'd be less police interaction that's required, and openly we might just have peace officers who remember that they're representing politicians in the community instead of law enforcement officers who think their job is to go around and monkey around in people's business and imply they've done something illegal to get some sort of reaction, and all that illicit, immoral, and illegal sort of approach really just makes society even worse. Now, when I talk about police, I'm not shaming their profession. I know they do a lot of work for a very little wage, but the truth is that those people are the people we call when we need help. They're also the people that people call when they want to lie about others, and it's not really fair if we don't have the right investigational tools like a journalist would have to determine whether or not something being said or done to an individual is not only lawful, but actually factual. Now, in my life, I've been a journalist for a short period of time because I put my writing skills into other things. I have written a script. I have written a play. I have done a lot of things in the last year, despite being homeless, despite following my own path to the Lord and doing other things in order to perform, in order to get food on my own table. You see, when the opportunities dry up, when everyone is looking for the youngest, hottest, neatest, cheapest labor, they're not always looking for a seasoned professional who has produced in his life. But openly, that might be your story too. If you've got a story, I'd love to hear it. If you'd like to be interviewed for your own clout, I can promise you that the interviews that I conduct do make an impact on the channels in which you provide your social media outlets and the opportunity to hear about who you are, to see who you are, and to literally have the audio file of you so that the people who call you know they're really talking to you. Now, that's a story for another day. At this time, I'm going to sign off and say simply, I really appreciate those of you who take the time to listen, to understand the struggles of a man's life, to compare it literally to your own lives, to making sure you're on track and going forward in a way that makes you feel good and makes you sure that you're having a positive impact on your old world, and openly that you're really reaching out to whatever you believe in this spiritual world to help you to make sure you're not harming another life in front of you. Because it's the little dots of harm that create the larger aspects of mayhem that we hear about all day long in the news. Now, this has been Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications, LLC, saying thanks for listening to my story, talking about your opportunities in life, and literally putting food over no one's mouth is not what we're doing here. We're actually looking at how do we produce a life worth living and a retirement worth having in a way that people go on for as long as they possibly can in the Lord's house and on this land. Thanks for listening.